there's no smell to it, I encourage them also to go with their finger over the cow pie. That's why it's called cow pie. And you actually, there's a very beautiful membrane, mucus membrane on that manure, which keeps everything in so it doesn't smell. And then the most amazing thing is that I say, now look here, I drop the cow pie and want to shake the hand. Okay? Most of them don't want to shake my hand, and then I show them my hand and I say, well, it's completely clean, what's wrong? Yeah. This is what I call quality. Yeah. When you have this kind of quality at the back end, and for me, judging the quality of milk, I judge it by what comes out of the back of the cow. Mm-hmm. That is the ultimate quality control for me. If the milk, in the summer it's a little bit different because of the green grass, but in the winter that is for me the quality test for good milk. All right.
Better clean inside and outside.
Pardon?
Better clean inside and outside.
Yeah. So then comes the question: what do we feed the cow? How many stomachs does a cow have?
Four.
Why does a cow have four stomachs? Yeah. To digest properly, because the cow, the goat, and the sheep are the only animals who can produce protein out of roughage. No other animal can do that. And that is this healing protein, what you have in the milk. Yeah? That you actually, out of hay, out of roughage, and it's a whole factory in the cow, and you would look at that, studying that is fascinating. These bacteria, how it changed from acid to neutral, to acid to neutral, until it then comes out. And that is what makes it so fascinating, yeah? That when you start working with an animal like that, and you understand why you cannot manipulate it, what we have in the modern dairy feeding, they now, actually for many, many years, feeding protein which doesn't have to go through the stomach. Yeah? It's called bypass protein, which should go directly into the udder of the cow. So that, because if it would go through the stomach, it would dismantle the protein and it wouldn't come out as the protein as they wanted, because the cow tries to get rid of protein. Yeah? So that's whole process of how they're feeding cows nowadays. Hardly any hay, mostly grains, high production. So they're forcing the cow into a chronic state of disease. How that works is, when you have too much protein yourself, it's actually too much, it becomes poison in your body. The cow is continuously poisoned with the protein we pump in these cows, with the soybeans and so on. And then the cow tries to get rid of that as quick as possible.
Through the
and
milk.
That is the illusion we have. High
Through
production milk is nothing else than trying to depoison your body, to detoxify your body. And that is how they achieve the 30,000 liters of milk, by simply make the cow chronically ill.
That's why I call it effluent.
Effluent, that's right.
It's an effluent.
Yeah. So it's nothing, not, people say pus, it still looks like milk, but it is, in fact, it is a pus which comes out of the cow, because the cow just tries to get rid of all that protein which literally poisons the cow. So the udder is continuously inflamed, is chronically inflamed, and used as a discharge for all the poison the cow is used to now.
Including antibiotics and everything else.
And then comes all the other stuff in, you know, the antibiotics and the whatever they put in there. So, now feeding. Very strict feeding program. And this should be uncompromised. When you want raw milk, the demands are no grains, and I'm talking no grains for the production of milk. If you have therapeutical, let's say when a cow has a calf fresh and it needs just a boost, like, you know, like we have our oatmeal in the morning, different story. But having grains for the production of raw milk is a no-no. Any farmer who produces raw milk based on grain diet should be not allowed to produce raw milk, or at least you should say, no, I don't want the milk. I know how it works. If you don't show some kind of activity on your side, you leave it all up to the politicians. You know, we can win the court case, and the next thing what will happen is that the politicians say, well, oh, we better regulate that. We allow raw milk, but we regulate it, and we regulate it so that it's for sure regulated out of
existence.
And I want to, and for me, the main thing was I want to prevent that. And here comes again in Gary, because Gary is my walking consciousness. he always stands with a baseball bat behind me to remind
I'm just reminding him.
Yeah, to remind what the issue here is. And that is where you get your piece of paper, raw milk warning, it spells it all out, okay? Kasha Canada was founded based on the concerns that if we are not proactive, the government will come in. If we win, you know, the second and the third round, then the government comes in and tells you, and for sure when the government comes in, they will establish the wrong regulations, yeah? They will tell exactly the wrong thing in order to fail, that the raw milk movement will fail. Yeah? So they will encourage you to have high producing cows, everything which makes it, which proves the point for them that after 3 years, the whole experiment failed, too many people get sick. And that is what I want to prevent. I want to make sure that we are, as a group, become as a producer, and I call you all now producers, as a producer group, are proactive in regards so that the government doesn't come in and regulate us. We want basically establish a credible and reasonable and believable structure so that we can not certify. We don't want to be another milk marketing board. What we want is to establish a quality seal. Yeah? And I call it the golden seal of raw milk. Yeah? Which basically gives you the assurance, if you go to the farm, I'm not telling you to go only to these farms, you can go to any farm you want, but if you want to be a conscious raw milk drinker, and are concerned about your children and whatever, then you need to look at some kind of measurement, and that is what we try to establish, the seal of quality, yeah? So, we have two dairy inspectors, independent dairy inspectors. I worked with them for many, many years, and they're accredited by the government, but they're not working for the government. They're doing organic inspections. They have done a lot of organic inspections in the U.S. and here. And one is Gary Lean, and the other one is Tom Kassan. And they both agreed to do the dairy inspections for our cow share operations. So what they're doing is they have a whole list of going through when they go through the barn. Say, is the barn clean? Is the barn whitewashed? Are there lots of flies around? Are there fly screens on the door? You know, how is the equipment? Is the equipment clean on the surface? Are the people going from the barn with cow shit on their feet into the milk house? Basic, you know, common sense questions. And so he has this check thing, then he issues us a report, and the report then says it doesn't recommend passed or not, because that's not his recommendation. He simply sends us the report, and there are these check marks, excellent, bad, and so on, and then we go through, and the next step is, if there are problems, then we start working with a farmer. We're not saying you're not certified. We then go back to the farmer and said, we need to address this issue, yeah? And in order to solve that problem, and there's several ways how we do that. I'm going, when farmers ask me, I go usually out there and I explain them, you can do that a certain way. And then finally, okay, then there's two other steps before that. That we require that the farms who want to do cow sharing, that they go through a cow share college, it's called Cowshare College, where we do the basic training, what I talked about, the basic training, what is it in order to, for your own protection, what you need to do in order to produce safe raw milk. there's two levels of it, cow shaped college. One, you go through the soil fertility, breeding, feeding, whatever. You also go through the social commitment you're going into. Farmers are usually loners out in the wilderness and then wilderness, and then suddenly they're confronted with 200 farm families coming happy, singing into the farm. Farmers panic. Some cannot handle that. And that is why, what is required to do a cow share? It's a different social commitment. Yeah? You're suddenly opening your farm up to a certain scrutiny of your consumers, and you have an obligation. Yeah? You have an obligation. You have, I always say, there's an open door policy you have to adopt. It doesn't mean that they can come on Sunday morning or after 10 o'clock at night, but there should be always this openness that when people want to see a farm, you need to go there and do something else. Back when they get into cow share. What I want to do is, my goal is to erase the dollar sign in their eyes before they even start. Mm-hmm. Yeah? If you go in, if farmers go in because of the dollar sign, forget it, it will fail. I have seen that too many times. Yeah? Because the commitment you do is, it is a significant commitment.